The Sacred Science by Nick Polizzi, An Ancient Healing Path for the Modern World. To my wife Michelle, who taught me how to laugh from the heart no matter what life brings, and to my two sons, River and Rowan, the greatest teachers I've ever known, this one's for you. Note to reader, woven throughout this book are practices and other pieces of native wisdom that you can put to use in your life right now. These practices were shown to me by the healers you are about to meet, and it is with their permission that I've included them in this book. Please, for your safety and the safety of those around you, be careful when experimenting with these techniques. They can be life-changing, but can also do harm if used improperly. Introduction. The afternoon heat in this place never disappoints. My left eye blinks away a nagging bead of sweat while trusty forefinger and thumb locate and remove a mosquito on the skin just above my sticky t-shirt collar. The breed in these parts comes handily equipped with an anesthetic on its proboscis that numbs you as it drains your blood so you don't feel the itch until the feast is over. No free lunches in this place, senor. I'm seated on the edge of a simple wooden chair tucked in the corner of a thatch-roofed jungle kitchen somewhere along the Amazonian border of Brazil and Peru, staring down the barrel of a very intimidating, albeit colorful, jug of liquid. The weathered brown hands on the native fellow holding it out in front of me speak to the decades he has spent navigating the bush, like the generations who have come before him. His name is Arturo, and he is the village curandero. Men and women of this ancient profession are thought to have an extrasensory relationship with the local plant spirits, which allows them to harness their power to cure the sick. I've heard it said that true curanderos, or shamans, are born with this skill and have little choice but to follow the calling. Arturo, who comes from a long line of medicine men, promised to bring me some of his family's legendary elixir for strength and vitality, and well, here it is. The liquid inside the repurposed 2-liter soda bottle on the table before me is mostly transparent, revealing a cluster of twigs, leaves, seeds, and insect thoraxes floating within. This is what men and women in my tribe drink every day before we go out to work. It's got 20 different ingredients and packs quite a kick. We all use it to heal head pain. Arturo holds the bottle up to the light, proudly identifying each of the floaters and sharing a bit about what they do to enhance the brew's potency. The word heal is a tricky one. These four letters seem straightforward in the modern world, but around here, healing can involve just about anything, from a bandage and some aloe on a scraped knee to an all-night plant ceremony that brings you as close to your existential edge as you can get, short of death itself. Heal stems from the old English word hal, which evolved into two other terms as well, whole and holy. 10 years ago, I would have thought these three words were totally unrelated, but staring into the eyes of the shaman before me, I now know better. They're as intertwined as the jet-black braid resting on his left shoulder. Are those insects in there? I ask, knowing the answer. These? Fire ants. They have a painful bite, but their bodies contain powerful medicine. Really good for you. I smile and nod with feigned excitement. He twists off the fat plastic cap with an Inca Cola logo on it, and to our surprise, the bottle burps out an effervescent hiss, like a bottle of, well, Inca Cola. Salud. Arturo pushes the bill of his well-worn trucker hat back from his brow and brings the full bottle to his lips, lifting the butt end high in the air. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 strong pulls later, he lets out a long, followed by, ooh-wee, this is a strong batch. Then it's my turn. Prueba, mi amigo, he urges. Judging by the look of casually disguised queasiness on the face of Arturo, who grew up drinking this stuff, I'm fairly confident it will not be a dull experience. There's a special mental place I like to go in moments like this. My line of work calls for a mildly insane streak to begin with, but repetition helps hone a peculiar skill that allows you to jump into these rabbit holes with less resistance from all those pesky survival instincts. This is a place of no thinking. There is no benefit in fearing or speculating what will happen next. Nor is there a shortcut around these obstacles. They are precisely where your path is meant to take you. The only thing to do is step forward and be ready for anything. A Taoist priest once shared a piece of wisdom that I find myself reaching for as Arturo offers his potion, about a student of Kung Fu and his master. As the student's training advanced, his master would come at him with increasingly intense flurries of punches and kicks, fists thrusting through the air, interspersed with painful blows from able feet. The student's natural inclination was to try and calculate what the master would do next, but the dance unfolded too quickly for formulaic thought, each second loaded with 5 to 10 strikes that could come from any direction. If the master ever sensed that his pupil was using a pattern defense against his attacks, the punishment would be severe. "Never anticipate," said the master. "Always be ready." "Salud." I nod at my smiling friend, hoping I'm hiding my own preemptive queasiness better than he's hiding his. Up goes the bottle, and down goes the long-lost elixir of youth. The following true story is told through the eyes of an average white American male from New England who thought he knew something about himself and the world, until he dipped a toe into the world of shamanism and realized rather suddenly that he did not. In this book, you will meet a number of odd characters. Among them are two shamans, a vegetalista with an encyclopedic mind for medicinal jungle plants, a band of 8 fearless patients willing to do anything to heal their illnesses, and my rough and tumble film crew. You may be asking yourself, what business does an ordinary guy from Connecticut have trekking through the pristine tropics of South America? Very good question. My name is Nick, and after healing naturally from a serious health challenge in my mid-20s, I decided to dedicate my life to an exploration of the ancient healing arts. This journey took me to the corners of the world, into the villages and homes of indigenous people who still use the sacred medicines and ceremonies of their ancestors. Somewhere along the way, fate landed a camera in my hands, and it became apparent that guerrilla-style filmmaking was a great way to preserve this fast-fading shamanic knowledge and bring these vital healing secrets to those in need of them. But some things are too expansive to be adequately captured on film, and anyone who has spent time in the tribal lands of the Amazon jungle or neighboring Andes mountains will tell you there is enough mystery here to fill lifetimes of exploration. So I'll be lending you the 20/20 lenses I was born with in my eye sockets for the ensuing chapters, as we dive into an unlikely healing expedition that was supposed to be an intrepid documentary, but turned out to be a portal of infinite transformation. My crew and I thought we were setting off to make a daring movie that would put the indigenous medicines of the rainforest to the ultimate test on real patients. It never occurred to us that we'd have to rewire our reality and confront the forgotten parts of ourselves in the process. This book is all about shamanism, a word that is shrouded in mystery and often misinterpreted. So before we get too far ahead of ourselves, let's get clear on what exactly that term means. The word shaman itself is Tungusic, originating in the remote Altai Mountains of Siberia. It translates literally to one who knows. In the traditions of Siberia, Mongolia, and parts of China, the word is used to describe an individual who bridges the physical world and the realm of the spirits in order to bring balance to their tribe and heal the sick. They accomplish this by entering altered states of consciousness, whether induced by drum, psychoactive plant medicine, controlled exposure to enclosed heat, or other environmental aid. Anthropological evidence of shaman figures can be found in cultures all around the world, dating back to our prehistory on this planet. One such example lies in a 5,000-year-old cave painting in Tassil, Algeria, that depicts a shaman with the head of a bee surrounded by mushrooms. Older cave paintings found in France and Spain depict hybrid animal humans that many historians believe are shamanic in nature as well. The name used to describe this position of healer priest in society varies with the native language of each particular region, but remarkably, the basic role and techniques used do not. A large number of the rites used by medicine men and women from different corners of the world are undeniably identical, aimed at pulling back the veil of this reality in order to purify the patient from within. Hardliners argue that because true shamanism originated in the forests of Siberia and Mongolia, only the native healers from these regions should be referred to as shamans. But native healers from the Americas, Africa, Australia, and Europe with similar practices utilizing altered states are often referred to as shamans as well because the term so precisely describes their craft. Shamanism is often referred to as a lineage of direct transmission because shamanistic knowledge is passed down by word of mouth from generation to generation without any written account. In teaching an apprentice, a shaman not only shows him or her the ceremonial practices and medicinal herbs, but also demonstrates how to be in this world. Shamans are a living bridge between this dimension and the one we cannot see. Their fate is predetermined by their bloodline or through an unintended initiation, which usually manifests as a close encounter with death. I have grown to know and deeply respect a number of these men and women, but they do not share their knowledge lightly. Centuries of oppression, as well as the exploitation of native traditions, have all but wiped out these lineages. The true wisdom keepers that remain have learned to keep their ancestral knowledge safe, sharing it only with a select few whom they trust. One cardinal rule of the documentary filmmaker is to earn the trust of your subject while never forgetting what your job is, to document, not participate. But when it comes to highly sacred and often private shamanic ceremonies.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.